So they said, we're not buying any of this tasting products in our community anymore. So as gang members, you know, we were little boys, and we went to this little store to get a little bread, you know, and that kind of thing every day. So we had to make a decision. And we used to love those tasty pies and cakes. Well, it was a serious sacrifice. This racism was hurting us really bad. So at age, 10 and 11 years old, that's when I first got involved. I said, well, if we can buy the tasty products, if we can have more tasty cakes and pies, then nobody gonna have any. Our voice count was 98% effective. But he took over. Yeah. And we made sure nobody bought any tasty bread or tasty products. That was my first involvement, you see, in the civil rights movement. And I didn't think about that until many years later. Yeah. So it was about the same issue. Right there in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, in the 50s. Yeah. So, it was easy for me to get involved in the movement. And the movement came along, but I already had experience of how to mobilize and organize, because I didn't know about nonviolence. So, I'm not going to tell you what we did to enforce our way. It isn't necessary. Yeah, that father and mister. But it was 90% there. But there's some basic things I learned from Martin Luther King. Now, Jim Lawson was the one that trained us in Nashville. He specifically came down to Nashville to train us in nonviolent tactics to apply to the lunch counters in Nashville. And it was very effective. That's why I make sure that people understand that training and preparation is key to success. Some people say, well, you can't accomplish anything with this. That these people are absolutely crazy. And this, that, and the other. And that. No. There is no substitution for the training that you're. If you don't understand the system, then you're not going to ever make change. Just change people, change positions. But you have to change the order of things, the system. So we have to be very clear about our goals and what we're trying to accomplish. And I think I like about nonviolence is that the goal that you seek, ultimate goal, must pre-exist in every step you take toward the goal. In fact, you know the goal is possible because it's reflected in your means. When your ends can be seen in your means, then you know that your end is possible.
All right.
In other words, the way you go about it should show what you are about. Yeah, that's why the training is important. That's why we have a West Point.
That's right.
Leadership, not lead a canoe. So, in essence, what we're saying is that in addition to the different roles that people play, now you know what one of my roles was in the committee in Nashville, the student group, we call it? Okay. I had an interesting role. So you had Bevel there, you had Jim Bevel, and you had, John Lewis, and all of them there. And my role was to sit and shut up and to listen to everything that people were saying, but also to look them in the eye when they were talking. And if they were saying something in disagreement with somebody else, I would have to look them in the eye. And in short, my role was the peacekeeper within the group that was making peace. And we could not leave a meeting until I said so. Because I had to make sure that the people in the room, okay, didn't have any tension between them. And because you can't go out there risking your life with some folks who don't feel good about you. Because they might duck and break his throat. Yeah, somebody be throwing a brick at you. So when I said it was okay for us to dismiss, that's when we left. That was my role. I didn't do anything else. I knew about the strategies and everything. I talked to him before I got there about all my ideas and strategies. But in the meeting, I had a very specific role. No, didn't say one word. So I had to make sure everybody felt okay with each other. And when they said, is it time to leave? I would say, yes. We had to make sure. Now the other thing we have to make sure of is that in our efforts to bring about change, that we are clear, okay, on when we get that change. All right? And I'm talking about change, not chunk change. Okay? Yeah, can't sell for anything. You gotta make sure that the change is what you want. So, therefore, it has to be very clear in terms of framing your issue. And I'll give you an example. Like in Nashville, Lloyd's home was bombed and we had a big march downtown, and this time we had a silent march. You hear what I say? When the tension gets high, okay, then your action must take a low road, because it's also a powerful road. I didn't want folks to get all upset and people started, I didn't want them to think this was a mob coming downtown. So we didn't even chant like we used to do. It was a silent march. All you can do is hear the footsteps headed towards the city hall. And we got there. C.T. Vivian shouted at the mayor a little bit, but Diane Nash was the one that asked questions. When the tension gets high, then your questions must become more profound. That's when you ask questions. Okay? Because the purpose of asking questions is to get your opponent to rethink what they thought they knew. And the only way you can get them to rethink what they thought they knew is that you had to ask questions so that they will come to the conclusion and not you coming to a conclusion for them. So you have to rethink and ask questions. And I embrace nonviolence, okay? Now I'll just give you one example, okay, that one. And I'll get back to the issue. Stokely and I actually were cellmates of the Freedom Rides. The city jail. We happened to be cellmates. We didn't choose, you know, we happened to be. And C.T. Vivian was my first roommate, cellmate. And when we moved around, and they shifted us, Stokely. So Stokely and I, he was a philosophy major at Howard University. Yeah, philosophy major. And I was at American Baptist College in Nashville, theological major. Okay. We stayed up all night arguing. There was no sleep there. And Stokely had a very interesting going around attacking people. But he said if someone attacked him, he had the right as an individual to defend himself by attacking them back. Equal justice. Yeah, that's what he called it, equal justice. An eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth. Somebody knock your eye out, and you know, you have a right to knock their eye out. You knock your tooth out, you have a right to knock, and if you mess around and knock two teeth out, you have to give them one of your own. Equal justice. You didn't know at the time, but I know all about equal justice. In fact, it was Hammurabi who came up with the idea of equal justice. Hammurabi was a lawgiver, you know, like Moses. And he said, because the previous policy was that somebody had knocked your eye out, you couldn't replace it. So you had a right to knock the other person's eye out, and in fact, all their eyes out, and then go kill the tribe, and then kill all the sheep, and the sheep dog too. Because you couldn't replace your eye. So Hammurabi said, no, we'll annihilate the whole universe if we did that. So let's have equal justice, one eye for one eye. And that was Stokely's position. So I just asked him a question. So you're telling me, Stokely, if somebody knocked one of your eyes out, that you would knock their eye out? Yeah. Equal justice. Well, suppose they knock your other eye out. How? You don't see how to knock that eye out. Well, so this whole goal of having a blind smacker to society didn't take us very far. I didn't argue with him, I got him to argue with himself. Yeah. And that's the key to it. If somebody differs with you, okay, what questions do you need to ask to get them to think like Hegel? Hegel believes in the thesis, the antithesis, but he believes in bringing them together in the synthesis. Like music. You know what synthesizes music together? Jazz.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. So my point is, we have to consider the change that we want and how are we going to get the change? How are you going to get people to come over rather than win over them? Mm-hmm. Win them over.
Mm-hmm.
Who was it, Napoleon, who said no revolution has ever been won unless you're able to win the sympathy, if not the actions, okay, of the majority? Who do you think passed the Civil Rights Bill? Who do you think passed the Voting Rights Bill? That's what I'm talking about. Yeah. Win them over. And that's what Martin Luther King was all about. How do we structure our movement in such a way that we win people over, have them come to a new conclusion? And we have to work with that. We have to work with them. Now, I know it's hard. I'm not talking about no easy stuff. If it was easy, then we wouldn't be here to talk about it.
Amen.
It's hard. And wait, I need to pause here. You know, I'm so impressed with you, Andrew. You are doing what the movement should be doing.
Amen. Amen.
First of all, it's coalitions, bringing people together, groups together. Martin Luther King, that's how he was able to succeed. The MIA in Montgomery, the Montgomery Improvement Association, was made up of the NAACP, the labor union, okay? All right? The churches, okay? And women's organizations. Now, if you're just going to have a move, that's one thing. But if it's been anything, you got to, you know, bring people together and let people be able to respect their particular issues. And then what you do is find a common issue that you work, because you can't work on all of them at the same time. You got to get coalition, and then you've got to have consensus. Us. Okay? Yeah. And one at a time. That's why we were able to succeed in the movement. There was a lot of segregation in Montgomery, but we focused on the buses. Yeah. In Nashville, one at a time. We did the movie theaters. Second, after we did the sit-ins and the lunch counters and that kind of thing. And then we jumped to the restaurants, and then on down to the Freedom Rides. Okay? And then voter registration. And I want to talk about that too at some point. But the other thing I want to say is that the Freedom Rides, for example, while you have what you call a destination, the most important thing is understanding your destiny. There's a destination, but there's also a destiny. And you've got to be clear about that. In the case of the sit-ins in Nashville, after the lawyer's home was bombed, and we had this march, and then we met with the mayor, and the mayor formed a biracial committee. In fact, it's called the Mayor's Biracial Committee. He had some black lawyers on there, you know, college president, and stuff, et cetera. And when they got their committee together, they called us. We called ourselves the Student Central Committee in Nashville. That was our group. That was the SNCC affiliate, the Student Central Committee. And it was made up of students representatives from different colleges and universities there in Nashville. So we went down to meet with them, and guess what? When we got there to the meeting place at City Hall, they wanted to meet with us one by one. And they had a whole group, and they gonna present a proposal to us. But they wanted us to come in one by one. Now, our students, you know, they're very mature, you know, that kind of stuff. They said, no, if you want to meet with us, then you meet with us. Okay? So they began to walk away. And I said, wait a minute. If we walk away, we'll never know what their proposal was. So let's go in. We trust each other. One by one, we go in, listen to their proposal, say thank you, and then we'll say we get back to you. Okay? We trust each other, so hey, what you gonna do? No, that's what we'll do. So they, after some persuasion on their part, which meant I had to ask a whole lot of questions to get them to thank. Okay? Yeah. They agreed. You know what the proposal was? I know you don't believe this, but I'm a Baptist preacher. They gave us a scenario like 30 lunch counter seats at the lunch counter. First 10 for whites. The middle 10 integrated. You can sit any way you want to, black and white, and sit together. And then at the end, 10 seats for blacks. Oh. Well, they wanted equality. They say, y'all want equality, then we got something for everybody. Those who want to sit segregated, and those who want to sit integrated, okay, then that'd be fine. Okay? That's respecting everybody's position. That's what you call equality. Yeah. And besides, once the blacks and the whites start to be sitting at the same lunch counter, it's integrated. So you don't want integration, you got integration. What's wrong with that? What's wrong with it? You know what's wrong with it? You never compromise principle. The principle is, if there is a vacant seat at the lunch counter, It doesn't matter what race you are or what color you are. Sit at the lunch counter and eat. That's the purpose of being there. Mm-hmm. But you know what they argued? Some black folks might not be able to feel comfortable eating with white folks. It might get indigestion. Since they had never eaten with white folks before, you know. And that was not true. Who do you think worked in the kitchen?
Amen.
Black and white folks worked in the kitchen. The way you think they ate in the kitchen. They weren't even thinking about the fact that in the homes, white folks' homes, black folks eat the food right there with them. In fact, they feed the people. They feed the elderly folk who can't handle things themselves. They feed.